Good evening, and welcome to all of you watching. I'm Lucy.
And I'm Ewan.
And we're your hosts for this evening. We're so glad that you're able to join us for what is due to be a spectacular evening of drama, with performances from a mixture of our students here at Reading Blue Coat in their first performances of the year.
Now, around the world, theatres have been severely affected by the COVID-19 crisis, and sadly, the West End has now been closed for over 6 months, with thousands not able to work. But here at Blue Coat, we are honoured to be keeping the arts alive, and with all the safety measures in place, we've been creating innovative ways to share our theatre with our community whilst keeping everyone safe.
There is no doubt that a live audience is a fundamental part of theatre. However, we are delighted to be able to share this evening of drama with you and highlight some of the incredible talent here at Reading Blue Coat.
Now, the new Year 10 drama students have begun their GCSE drama career by exploring scripted scenes from a variety of plays. Over the last 3 weeks, the boys have been tasked with developing their performance skills and staging these extracts. The first of these scenes is an extract from the Tarantino variation by Seth Cranmer. This fast-paced, absurdly ridiculous scene is sure to entertain and is performed by Barney, Matty, and Ollie. Please enjoy.
Freeze! Don't move!
Hold it!
Put it down!
Not until he drops his.
No way!
I mean it!
So do I!
You're gonna have to pry this gun out of my cold, dead hand!
That can be arranged.
Do it and I kill you!
Not before I kill this guy.
You shoot, then I shoot.
Okay then!
Your funeral!
Let's go!
Fine!
Fine!
Fine! This a little awkward.
I'm feeling a lot of tension here.
I need to urinate. Peace and die!
What?
Squirt and you're done.
But you're not even pointing your gun at me.
So?
So you can't exactly threaten me.
Fine, then I'll threaten him.
Hey, the guy's got a gun.
He lets one drop out and I'll kill
you. I can hold it.
Hang on.
What?
Why are you yelling?
Because I'm a little nervous, okay? You got your gun to my head.
I can relate.
Me too.
You don't really want to shoot me, do you?
Wanna bet?
Go ahead, shoot it.
I will.
So do it.
You don't have got the guts?
No, it's the balls you're missing.
Oh, do it. I'll shoot this guy right in the head.
Hey, what now?
Why do you want this guy to shoot me?
Yeah, good question. Why do you want me to shoot him?
So I can shoot you.
Oh,
well, what if I shoot you first?
Shoot me first?
Yeah, what if I blast right through your eyeballs first?
Well, then he'll smear your brains all over the pavement.
You will?
Will?
Absolutely you will.
Absolutely I will.
Why?
Yeah, why?
Because I have this gun to your head.
Boom!
Bam! Kablooey!
So let me see if I got this straight.
Sure.
Go ahead. If I shoot you in the side of the head.
Well, then I'm going to blast a big huge hole through his skull.
And I'm going to smear your brains all over the ground.
So everybody dies?
Yeah.
Looks that way.
And everybody's okay
Can
with
I
it?
Say something?
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
I think I'm pointing my gun at the wrong guy.
What?
You're joking.
No, I think I'm pointing my gun at the wrong guy.
Oh, that's great. That's just great.
Sorry.
I mean, now is a hell of a time to say a thing like that. I mean, what are we supposed to do now, huh? You want to tell me?
Me too.
Oh, no.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, do we need to be reviewing who's supposed to be shooting who here?
Who?
What?
Who is supposed to be shooting whom here?
Really?
Yeah, I think he's right.
Oh, I was never any good at grammar.
Okay. Who is supposed to be shooting whom here?
Well, I want to shoot you.
And I want to whack him.
To be honest, I'd actually rather...
Alright, let's go!
Time to die!
I'm gonna blow you away alone, you're gonna make snow angels!
Yeah? Well, I'm gonna blow your brains out and throw them in the air like confetti!
Not before I kill you! Carve your body up with a knife, use your skin as furniture covers, turn both your ears into a necklace, and screw your skull through your right eyeball!
Damn!
That didn't stop anything!
Oh, I'm starting to get a headache.
Anybody got any more bright ideas?
Why don't we all put our guns away until we can figure this out?
How about on three?
Fine.
Okay, you start.
Me?
No, him.
Why him?
Why not?
Because he's got a gun to my head.
Fine, you start.
Me?
No, him.
Why him?
Oh, for God's sake!
I just want to know why I can't start.
Fine!
Okay. One.
Two.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
No, you. Two.
Three. Yeah, we probably should have explained. expecting.
Okay, this time for real, alright? This time for real.
Yeah.
One,
two, three! One, two, three! Oh, we're gonna be here all day!
Let's just shoot each other and get this over.
I still need to take a piss.
Alright, that does it. I've had it with you two. Had it.
Be cool, be cool.
Don't do anything stupid. I mean, all this gun pointing and no shooting is pathetic. You're pathetic. You don't deserve to wear those cool black suits.
Hey!
Don't insult the dress code.
Oh, I'm not spending another minute here. You see this?
Hey, what do you think you're doing, man?
This is my ticket out of here.
There's no need for this.
And if either of you try to get my way, so help me. I'll do it. I'm crazy enough, I swear.
Hey, put your gun back at me, man.
Or at me? You can point
hey, I asked him first.
So what? I make a better time.
Says who?
Says me.
All right, Mr. Better Time, what if I blast a hole through your chest?
What if I blast a hole through yours?
Oh, you two, stop arguing.
Is to die for.
Tonight we are aiming to raise money for the Theatre Community Fund with a target contribution of £750. If you are able, please follow the link down below and help to support this wonderful fund. We are currently well over 50% of our target, with a special shout out to Diane with a lovely message which read, "Well done for keeping the show on the road and for helping others who can't." So please, feel free to leave your name for shout-outs later in the performances, and thank you for your donations.
Now, the Theatre Community Fund has been established to support the theatrical artists and professionals whose livelihoods and creative futures have been threatened in the wake of COVID-19. This fund will be separated into two strands: hardship grants in partnership with the Fleabag Support Fund, and creative and innovation grants.
Grants will be distributed in partnership with the Royal Theatrical Fund. The RTF was founded in 1839 by Charles Dickens and supports those in the entertainment world who are unable to work due to illness, infirmity or injury. Our next performance is a new addition to Bluecoat's drama department, performing a monologue from Dennis Kelly's play DNA. Anna takes on the role of Leah, a teenager, who after working with her friends to absolve any culpability for the death of their peer Adam, decides to flee the town. In this monologue, Leah reveals her intention to leave to her crush, Phil.
I'm going. I'm out of here. I'm gone. This is it. I'm running away, Phil. Did you see Jan at Anna's memorial? Floods of tears. It was wonderful. Everyone felt wonderful. It's incredible, the change. This place. You're a miracle worker. Everyone's happy. You know that. You notice that. Jackie was on the telly. They use that clip on every channel. She's like a celebrity. There are second years asking for her autograph. Richard's named his dog Adam. Mark's mum said if her baby's a boy, she's going to call him Adam. Funny thing is, they're all actually behaving better as well. I saw Jan helping a first year find the gym. Mark's been doing charity work, for Christ's sake. Maybe being seen as heroes is making them behave like heroes. Yeah. Everyone's happy. Well, it's not all roses, you know. Brian's on medication. Did you know that, Phil? Did you know that they put Brian on medication? Yep. Brian's off his head. John Tate hasn't been seen in weeks, and the postman's facing the rest of his life in prison. But you know, omelettes and eggs. As long as you have your waffle, who cares?
Now, our performance schedule for 2020 was due to kick off with the classic production of An Inspector Calls, which was due to be staged in the Buttery this week. Having auditioned the production virtually in May and having cast the drama, we are delighted to still share with you this evening some extracts from this incredible production.
An Inspector Calls by J.B. Priestley is a play that revolves around the apparent suicide of a young woman called Eva Smith. In the play, the unsuspecting Burling family are visited by the mysterious Inspector Gould. He arrives just as they are celebrating the engagement of Sheila Burling to Gerald Croft. The inspector reveals that a girl called Eva Smith has taken her own life by drinking disinfectant. The family are horrified, but initially confused as to why the inspector has called to see them.
What follows is a tense and uncomfortable investigation by an all-knowing inspector through which the family discover that they are in fact all caught up in this poor girl's death.
Well, that's it, is it? I believe several hundred girls working here, and, you know, they do keep changing. This young woman, Evie Smith, was a bit out of the ordinary. I found a photograph of her in her lodgings. How do you remember her from that?
Any particular reason why I shouldn't see this girl's photograph, Inspector?
There might be.
And the same goes for me, I suppose.
Yes.
Well, I can't imagine what it could be.
Nor could I.
Well, I must say, I do agree with them, Inspector.
It's the way I like to work. One person, one line of inquiry at a time. Otherwise, there's a muddle.
I see. Sensible, really.
We've had enough of that thought, Eric. I think you remember her now, don't you, Mr. Burden?
Yes, I do. She was one of my employees, and I discharged her.
Is that why she committed suicide? When was this, Father?
Keep quiet, Eric. Don't get excited. This girl left us nearly 2 years ago. Let me see. I believe it must have been in the early autumn
of 1910.
Yes, end of September 1910.
That's right.
Yes, sir, wouldn't you rather I was out of this?
Well, I don't mind you being here, Gerald. I'm sure you've no objection. Have you, Inspector? Perhaps I ought to mention first that this here is Gerald Croft, the son of Sir George Croft.
Mr. Gerald Croft, eh?
Yes. Incidentally, we've been modestly celebrating his engagement to my daughter Sheila.
I see. Mr. Croft is going to marry Miss Sheila Burley.
I hope so.
Then I'd prefer you to stay.
Look, there's nothing scandalous or mysterious about the business. It's a perfectly straightforward case. Well, this has happened nearly 18 months ago, almost 2 years ago. Surely this has nothing to do with this wretched girl's suicide, eh, Inspector?
No, I can't agree with you there.
Why not?
Because what happened to her then may determine what happened to her afterwards. And what happened to her afterwards may have driven her to suicide, chain of events.
Who? Because you like that, there's something what you have to say. I can't accept any responsibility. We still want to be responsible for everything that happened to everybody we'd have anything to do with. Which would be rather awkward, wouldn't it?
Rather.
We'd be put in an impossible situation.
By Jove, yes. As you were saying, Father, a man has to look after himself.
Yes, well, we need to go to all of that.
Go to what?
Just before you came, I'd been giving these young men some good advice. Now, about this girl, Eva Smith. I seem to remember her rather well now. She was a lively, good-looking girl. Country bred, I fancy. And she'd been working with one of our machine shops for over a year now. In fact, I believe the foreman there told me he was ready to promote her, what we like to call a leading operator. Head of a small group of girls. When they returned from their vacation that year, they were all rather restless. Suddenly decided to ask for more money. Well, they were averaging around 22 and 6, which is neither more or less than is generally paid in our industry. They wanted those rates raised, so they could average 25 shillings a week. Well, I refused, of course.
Why?
Did you just say why, Inspector?
Yes, why did you refuse?
Well, Inspector, I don't see if it's any concern of yours how I choose to run my business, is it now?
It might be, you know.
I don't like that term.
I'm sorry that you asked me a question.
Well, you asked me a question before that. Quite a necessary question, too.
It's my duty to ask questions.
Well, it's my duty to keep letting costs down. And if I agree to this demand for a new rate, then we'd have added around 12% to our labour costs. Does that satisfy you? So I said no. So they wouldn't consider it. We were paying the usual rates. If they didn't like those rates, then they could go work somewhere else. It's a free country, I told them.
Well, it isn't it. You can't be.
You're quite right.
Just keep out of this. We only started the works when this had begun. So they went on strike. I mean, it didn't last long, of course.
Not if it was after the holidays. There's all been bloke if I know them.
Well, you're right, Sheriff. They were. Until the strike, after a few weeks, pitiful affair. Well, we let all the girls come back at the old rates. Except for the 4 or 5 ringleaders. You know, the ones who started all the trouble. I marched down there myself and told them to clear out. This girl, Eva Smith, she was one of them. She had a lot to say, far too much. So she had to go.
You couldn't have done anything else.
He could. He could have kept her on instead of throwing her out.
Rubbish! If you don't come down hard on some of these people, they'll soon be asking for the earth.
I should say so.
They might. But it's better to ask for the earth than to take it.
Say your name was, Inspector.
A ghoul, G-double-O-L-L. L-E.
How do you get on with our chief constable, Colonel Roberts?
I don't see much of him.
Perhaps I ought to mention that me and him are rather good friends. We see each other fairly frequently. We play golf together up at the West Bromley.
I don't play golf.
No, I didn't suppose you did.
Well, I think it's a damn shame.
No, I've never wanted to play.
No.
About this girl, Eva Smith.
Why wouldn't you try for high wages? We try for the highest possible prices. I don't see why you'd have to throw her out just because she's a bit more spirited than the others. I'd have let her stay.
Unless you brighten up your ideas, you'll never be put in a position to let anyone stay or tell anyone to go. Time enough to face your responsibilities. Of course, that's something this public school, varsity line, doesn't seem to teach you.
We don't need to tell the inspector about all that, do we?
Well, I don't think we need to tell the inspector anything anymore. In fact, there's something I've left to tell him. Well, I told the girl to clear out, and she went. That's the last I ever saw of her. What happened to her then? Got into trouble? Go out onto the streets?
No, not exactly.
What's all this about the streets? Sorry, Mummy sent me in to ask why you didn't come along to the drawing room.
We should be along in a minute now. Just finish.
I'm afraid not.
Look, there's nothing else to know. I've just told you that.
What's all this about?
Nothing to do with you, Sheila. Run along now.
No, wait a minute, Miss Burling.
Look, Inspector. I consider this uncalled for and officious behaviour. Right, far from mine to report to you. I've told you everything I know, and it doesn't seem to be very important. I can't think of the slightest reason why you should drag my daughter into this unpleasant business.
What business? What's happening?
I'm a police inspector, Miss Burling. 2 hours ago, a young woman drank some strong disinfectant and died after several hours of agony. Tonight in the infirmary.
Oh, how horrible. Was it an accident?
No, she wanted to end her life. She felt she couldn't go any longer.
Don't tell me that's because I discharged from my employment nearly 2 years ago.
That might have started it.
Did she, Dad?
Yes, I did. She was causing trouble in the work. It was quite justified.
Yes, I think you were. We'd have done the same. Don't look like that, Sheila.
Sorry, it's just I can't help thinking about this girl destroying herself so horribly. And I've been so happy tonight. Oh, I wish you hadn't told me. What was she like?
Yes, 24. She wasn't pretty when I saw her tonight, but she had been pretty. Very pretty.
That is enough of that.
And I don't see how this inquiry gets you anywhere.
It's what happened after she left Mr. Burling's work that's important.
Well, obviously, I said that sometime.
And we can't tell you about that for the 12th of the dumpster.
Are you sure?
Well,
yes.
So you didn't just come here for me then?
No.
A quick contribution update. We're currently at 64% of our target with a total of £486. Thank you so much for everyone who has donated so far, and please keep those donations coming.
Now, up next, we have Mia, a new addition to the Blue Coat Drama Department. This evening, she's presenting a monologue that explores the tense relationship between a mother and a daughter. Fed up with the constant verbal abuse she's received, Mia's character takes this moment we're about to see to plea for a ceasefire to the incessant vitriol.
It makes it hard for me to tell you this. I wish we were close. I wish we were friends. I don't like waking up in the morning, scrambling your eggs with you shouting obscenities at me in the background for things that just don't deserve shouting. forget that, but you forget that I'm a person too. I'm not, you know, some peasant slave that you've hired to cook and clean. I am your daughter. I don't feel like I'm your daughter, but I am, I guess. These are the cards that we were dealt, Mum. I'm sorry that I'm not all that you hoped for and that this life that we live here together isn't glamorous and that Dad abandoned us when I was born and you can't make me feel like that's my fault. I didn't even know the guy. I'd never even met him and I just wanted to say that I try, you know, I try to be there for you and do all the things a good daughter's supposed to do for her mother, but you're just such a rude bitch sometimes and I can't take it anymore. Be nice to me. I'm worth enough to be treated nice. Treat me nice before I have an outburst. A real outburst. I'm talking a sumo outburst. Huge. So, treat me nice. Do you want some more coffee?
Next we have the second part of the Inspector Calls, where the Inspector uncovers Gerald's side of the story.
What's the matter with him?
Eric. Oh, he's
had rather too much to drink tonight. Do you see we're celebrating here?
Is one of them too used to drinking?
Eric? No, he's only a boy.
He's a young man. And some young men drink far too much.
And Eric is one of them.
Sheila!
Look, I don't want to get poor Eric in trouble. He's probably in enough trouble already, but we really must stop using these silly pretenses. This isn't the time to pretend that Eric isn't used to drinking. He's been steadily drinking for the past 2 years.
It isn't true. You know him, Gerald, and you're a man. You must know it isn't true.
Well, Mr. Croft, actually it is. I haven't seen much of him outside this house, but I have gathered that he does drink pretty hard.
And this is the time that you choose to tell me.
Yes, of course it is. This is what I talked about when I said building up a wall that's sure to be not bad. It makes it all the harder to bear.
Oh, but it's you and not the inspector here that's doing it.
Yes, but don't you see? He hasn't started on you yet.
If necessary, I shall answer any questions that the inspector here wishes to ask me. Though naturally, I don't know anything about this girl.
We'll see, Mr. Berlin.
You tried to persuade Eric to go to bed. He won't. He says you told him to stay up. Well, did you?
Yes, I did.
Why?
Because I shall want to talk to him, Mr. Berlin.
Well, I can't see why you should, but if you must, then I suggest you go do it now. Have him in, get it over with, and let the lad go.
No, I can't do that yet. I'm sorry, but he must wait his turn.
Look here, Inspector.
He must wait his turn.
No, I don't, and please be quiet, Sheila.
Inspector, I have told you before, I don't like your tone nor the way you are handling this inquiry, and I strongly don't propose to give you much more rope.
You needn't give me any rope.
No, he's giving us the rope so that we'll hang ourselves.
What is the matter with that child?
Overexcited, and she's refused to go to bed. Now come along, what is it you want to know?
At the end of January last year, this girl, Evie Smith, had to leave Millwoods because Miss Burling compelled them to discharge her. And she stopped being Eva Smith, became Daisy Renton. Mr. Croft, when did you first get to know her?
Where did you get the idea that I did know her?
You scared you're wasting your time.
As soon as I mentioned the name Daisy Renton, it was obvious you'd known her. You gave yourself away at once.
Doesn't surprise me.
And in any case, I already knew. When and where did you first meet her?
Right, if you must have it, I met her first sometime in March last year. It was at the Stalls Bar at the Palace. I mean the Palace Music Hall here in Bromley.
Well, we didn't think that you meant Buckingham Palace.
Thanks, you're going to be a great help, I can see. You said your part, and you're obviously going to hate this, so why on earth would you leave this to me?
Nothing would induce me. I want to understand what it means when a man says that he's so busy at the works that he can hardly ever come home and find time to see the girl that he's supposed to be in love with. I wouldn't miss it for the world.
Yes, Mr. Croft, in the Stalls Bar at the Palace Variety Theatre.
I happened to look in one night after a long, dull day. Seeing as the show wasn't very bright, I went down to the bar for a drink. It's a favourite haunt of women of the town.
Women of the town?
Yes. Well, I see no point in going to this now. Especially...
I think she really shouldn't hear the story at all. But you're forgetting that I'm supposed to be engaged to the hero of it. Go on, Gerald, you went down to the bar, which is your favourite haunt of women in the town.
I'm glad that I knew
Mr. Croft. What happened?
I didn't propose to stay long down there. I hate those hard-eyed, dough-faced women, but then I noticed a girl who looked quite different. She was very pretty. She had soft brown hair and big, dark eyes. My God.
What's the matter?
Sorry. I've suddenly realised, taking it in properly, that she's dead.
Yes, she's dead.
And probably between us we killed her.
Sheila, don't talk nonsense.
Wait, Mother.
Go.
She looked young and fresh and charming. And altogether out of place down there. And obviously she wasn't enjoying herself. Old Joe Megarty, half drunk and goggle-eyed, had wedged her into a corner with that obscene fat car.
There's no need to be so disgusting. And sure, you don't mean Alderman Megarty.
Of course I do. He's a notorious womanizer, as well as being one of the worst sots and rogues in Bromley.
Quite right.
Well, really? Alderman Megarty?
pounds.
Sheila!
Go on, please. The girl saw me looking at her and gave me a glance that was nothing less than a cry for help. I went over there and told Joe Megatee some nonsense, something about the manager having a message for him, got him out of the way. And then I told her that if she didn't want any more of that nonsense, then she'd better let me take her with her. She agreed at once.
Where did you go?
We went along to the country hotel. I knew it would be quiet that sort of night, and we had a few drinks and talked.
Did she drink much at the time?
No. She only had a port and lemonade or some such concoction. She wanted to talk about herself. A little friendliness, and I gathered that Joe Megatee's advances had left her rather shaken, as well they might.
She talked about herself?
Yes, sort of. She said her name was Daisy Renton, and that she lost both parents, and that she came originally from someplace outside Bromley. She also said she'd had a job at the works, but she had to leave after a strike. She said something about the shop too, but wouldn't say which it was, and was deliberately vague about what happened. I couldn't get any exact details from her about her past life. Though, what she did let slip, though she didn't mean to, was that she was desperately hard up and at that moment was actually hungry. I made the people at the county find some food for her.
And then you decided to keep her as your mistress.
What? Of course, Mother, it was obvious from the start. Go on, Gerald, tell my mother.
Discovered, not that night, but two nights later, when we met again, though not accidentally this time, of course, that actually she hadn't a penny and was going to be turned out of that miserable back room she had. It happened that a friend of mine, Charlie Burnswick, had gone off to Canada 6 months ago. He left me the key to a nice little set of rooms he had in Morgan Terrace. He asked me to keep an eye on them and said I could use them if I wanted to. So I insisted on Daisy staying there. I gave her a little money to keep her going. I want you to understand that I didn't install her there so that I could make love to her. I made her go to Morgan Terrace because I was sorry for her. I didn't ask for anything in return.
I see.
Yes, but why are you saying that to him? You ought to be saying it to me.
I suppose I ought to, really. I'm sorry, Sheila. I didn't mean for it to happen. I didn't mean for you to find out.
I know. But somehow he makes you.
But she became your mistress?
Yes. I suppose it was inevitable, really. She was young and pretty and warm-hearted and intensely grateful. I became at once the most important person in her life. You understand?
Yes, she was desperate. She was lonely. Were you in love with her?
Just what I was going to ask.
I really must protest.
Why are you protesting? It was you who turned this girl out in the first place.
I didn't any good employee you've done. What I was going to say was that I protest. In the way which my daughter, a young unmarried girl, has been dragged into this.
She's on the moon. She's here in Bromley, it's true.
And I was the one who got the girl turned out of her job in the first place. I'm not a child, so I have the right to know. Why are you in love with her, Gerald?
It's hard to say. I didn't feel about her as she felt about me.
Of course not. You were the wonderful fairy prince. You must have adored it, Gerald.
Well, I did for a time. Nearly any man would have done.
Probably about the best thing that you said tonight. At least it's honest. Did you go and see her every night?
No. I wasn't telling a complete lie when I said we'd been very busy at the works. We were very busy. But of course I did see a good deal of
it. I don't think we need any more disgusting details of that disgusting affair. I do, and we haven't had any details yet.
And you're not going to have any. You know, it wasn't disgusting.
It's disgusting me. But of course you didn't come into this, did you, Mother?
Is there anything else that you want to know, that you ought to know?
When did this affair end?
I can tell you exactly. It was in the first week of September. I had to go away on business for several weeks, and by that time, Daisy knew it was coming to an end. I broke it off definitely before I went. I didn't want to drag it out for her.
She had to leave those rooms?
Yes, we'd agreed about that. She said that she'd saved a little money over the summer. She'd been very economical in what I'd allowed her. Though she didn't want to take any more from me, but I insisted on a parting gift of enough money, though it wasn't so very much, just to see her through till the end of the year.
Did she tell you what she proposed to do after you'd left her?
No, she refused to talk about it. Though I did get the idea once or twice from what she'd said that she thought of leaving Bramley. Whether she did or not, I don't know. Did she?
Yes, she went away for about 2 months to some seaside place.
By herself?
Yes, she wanted to be alone, to be quiet. Just remember what you and her had in common.
How do you know that?
Well, she had left a rough sort of diary, and she said she had to be alone, quiet, remember, just to make it last longer. She felt there'd never be anything as good for her again, so she had to make it last longer.
I see. Well, I've told you all that I know.
That's all I want from you.
In that case, as I'm rather more upset by this business than I might appear to be, well, I'd like to be alone for a while. I'd be glad if you let me go.
Go where? Home?
No, I'll just walk about for a while. I'll come back.
All right, Mr. Croft.
But just in case you forget, or decide not to come back, Gerald, I think you better take this with you.
I see.
I don't dislike you as much as I did half an hour ago, Gerald. In fact, in some odd way, I rather respect you more than I've ever done. I knew, however, you were lying about those months when you hardly came near me, and I knew there was something fishy about that time, and at least you've been honest. And it wasn't my fault that she was just so desperate when you first met her. But this has made a difference. You and I are the same people who sat down for dinner here. We'll have to start all over again, getting to know each other.
Now, Sheila, look, I'm not offending you. But you must understand, a lot of young
men... Don't interfere, Father, please. Gerald knows what I mean.
Yes, I know what you mean. But I'll come back, if I may.
All right.
Well, really, I think we've had enough of that nasty business for one night.
I don't think so. Excuse me.
No.
He likes me. You know, he never got to cross. We talked about beer together. To this day, he never bothered me about coming from... I tell you what, he watched an unusual amount of tennis. You know, everything was tennis with him. His conversation peppered with little tennis metaphors. Well, sometimes I'd watch tennis with him. Never really liked it, though. Is it a terrible thing to say? That sometimes the company of men is kind of in some way what? Comforting. Oh, no. I don't mean to sound, you know, I don't mean anything other than... I tell you what, he had a house in the eastern suburbs of Toulon, in a town called Carcarraine, in the south of fucking France, for fuck's sake. You know, when I go there with Helen for the first time, we drive in her car. She's kind of a mix between being a little bit embarrassed, because, you know, ostensibly at least, at the time we were kind of what? Socialists. Just being really fucking proud of her, because her dad has a house in the south of France, and she's taking me there. And she's paying for the ferry because I'm skint. She keeps going on about how odd he is. You know, but she has a feeling that she thinks I'll like him. You know, I do. That's one of the things she says she likes about me. You know, I like people. People like me. They think I'm gentle. Absolutely no idea. People thought I was gentle. And she says she really likes this bit. This bit is one of the best bits of a man, she says. Which is just a phrase that just about sends me completely in love with her. And her nose and her smile and everything. Lucy was a caesarean. And when Helen was in labour there was a moment where I thought she could have died. You know, and I remember being a little bit embarrassed now, because I had to go into the toilet to change into my, what did I call it, scrubs, is it? And when I went in to change into my scrubs, I did have a little bit of a cry. And when I did ask God, you know, who I don't even think is fucking there in the first place, to make sure that Helen was alright. And I said, we can survive if we lose the baby, but I don't think I could have made it if she went and died on me. It's like talking to a photograph or the mirror. It has the same effect. You know, which isn't to discount it completely, but it's not God.
Thank you to Jude, who you've just seen performing an extract from Simon Stevens' monologue play, Seawall. A delicate story of love and grief, Jude played Alex, a young man who opens up about his wife, father-in-law, and daughter. Now, a quick apology for the audio issues we had in the Inspectacles extract. We will be uploading corrected versions after this performance so that you can watch them in their full glory. Also, a quick update on our funds. We have raised 69% of our total amount. And a quick thank you to Marie, who said a great evening and well done.
For our final Year 10 performance, we have an extract from The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas, a historical tragedy set in World War II based on John Boyne's 2006 novel of the same name. The Holocaust drama relates to the horror of a Nazi extermination camp through the eyes of 2 8-year-old boys. Bruno, the son of the camp's Nazi commandant, and Shmuel, a Jewish inmate. Please welcome Year 10's Tom and Alex to the stage.
I've been exploring, have you?
Yes, for almost 2 hours now.
Have you found anything?
Not really.
Nothing at all?
Well, I found you. I live in a house on this side of the fence, just over there.
Do you?
Yes,
I'm on the first floor. My name's Bruno.
I'm Shmuel.
What did you say your name was?
Shmuel. What do you say your name was?
Bruno.
I've never heard of that name.
I've never heard of your name either.
Shmuel. Shmuel.
I quite like the way that sounds when I say it. It's almost like the wind blowing.
Bruno. Yes. I think I quite like that name. Sounds like someone who's rubbing their arms to keep warm.
I've never met anyone called Shmuel before.
There are dozens of Shmuels on this side of the fence.
I've never met anyone else called Bruno either.
I might be the only one. Then you must be lucky.
Yes, I suppose I am. How old are you?
I'm 9. My birthday's April the 15th, 1934.
What did you say?
I said my birthday's April the 15th, 1934.
I don't believe it.
Why not?
No, I'm so sorry. It's not that I don't believe you. It's just that my birthday's April the 15th. And I was born in 1934. We've got the same birthday.
I don't think I've met anyone on the same birthday as me before.
We're like twins.
Sort of.
Do you have many friends?
Well, yes. Sort of.
Close friends?
Not really close. There are boys. Our age, I mean. On this side of the fence.
Oh, it's so unfair. Why do I have to be stuck over here
where there's no one to play with, and you get to be over there with dozens of friends. It's so unfair.
Where did you come from?
Berlin.
Where's that?
It's in Germany, of course. Aren't you from Germany?
I come from Poland.
But then, how are you speaking German?
You said hello in German, so I answered in German. Can you speak Polish?
No, I don't know anyone our age who could speak two languages.
Mama's a teacher in my school, and she taught me German. She said she'd teach me English one day, because it might be useful.
Poland. That's not as good as Germany, is it?
Why isn't it?
Well, because Germany is the greatest of all countries. We're superior. Where is Poland, anyway?
We're in Poland. This is Poland.
Is it?
Yes, it is.
I don't think so.
Well, where I come from, it's much nicer than this.
Do you like exploring?
I've never really tried it.
I'm going to be an explorer when I grow up. You see, the thing with it is if you've got to know whatever you found is actually worth finding. Sometimes great things are just out there waiting to be discovered. Like America. Other times, there are things not worth mentioning, like a dead rat in the back of a cupboard.
Which am I?
You're America, of course. Can I ask you something?
Yes?
Why are there so many of you on that side of the fence? And what are you doing there?
All I know is this. Before I came here, I lived with my mother, father, and my brother in a small flat above a shop. We had breakfast every morning together. And when we went out to school, Papa mended watches that people brought to him. I had a beautiful watch that he gave me, but I don't have it anymore. It had a golden face, and I'd wind it up every night.
What happened to it?
They took it from me.
Who?
The soldiers, of course. One day, things started to change. I came home from school, and Mama was making these armbands out of a special cloth. And every time we left the house, we had to wear one of these armbands.
My father has one of those, on his uniform, right here. It's very nice. It's red, with a black and white design in it. Like a cross, but with extra bits.
Yes, but they're different, aren't they?
No one's ever given me an armband.
But I never asked to wear one.
I think I'd quite like one.
We wore the armbands for a few months, and then Mama said we had to move out of our house.
That happened to me too. The Fury came for dinner, you see, with a woman. And the next thing I knew, we'd moved all the way out here. Did he come to your house and do the same thing?
No, but we were told we had to move to a different part of Krakow. And the soldiers built a big wall. And we all had to live in one room.
All of you? In one room?
And not just us. There was another family, and they were always fighting with each other.
You can't have all lived in one room.
All of us, 11 in total. And it was impossible to sleep. There was this one boy who kept hitting me when I did nothing wrong.
Gretel hits me sometimes. She's my sister, and a hopeless case. But one day I'll be bigger and stronger than she is.
And one day, the soldiers came, and they took us to a train. And the train was horrible.
There was no room in the carriages for one thing, and there was nowhere to breathe.
That's probably because you all got onto one train. When we got here, there was another train on the other side of the platform, but no one really seemed to notice it.
I don't think we would have been allowed on that train. We weren't allowed to get off our carriage.
The doors were at the end.
There weren't any doors.
Of course there were doors. They're just at the end, past the buffet section.
If there were any doors, we would have all got off. And when we arrived, we were at a very cold place, and we all had to walk here.
We had a car.
And Mama was taken away from us, and Papa, my brother and I, we've been living in those huts over there ever since.
It's very much like what happened to me.
We've now raised £521 of our total target. Now, for those of you that missed the beginning, all of this money is going to theatres all across the UK. And of course, there is no cost for tonight's performance, so your donations really will make a difference to theatre makers all across the UK. Now, in A-level drama, students were tasked with reinterpreting a classic playtext and bringing their own creative flair. They're challenged with considering all aspects of staging their version of the play and take inspiration from a theatre practitioner or theatre company.
This year, the Year 13s have been exploring Sophocles' ancient Greek tragedy, Antigone. By reinterpreting this classic drama, students have reimagined the plot and context for their final examination.
Now, although their examination is still 2 weeks away, the students have boldly decided to give us a taste of their work. In the style of Frantic Assembly and set in the context of the war, please welcome to the stage Maddie, Molly and Daisy, one of the Year 13 A-level drama groups, with their version of Antigone.
Thank you. wanted to talk to me. I had a lovely delivery this morning from our editor. An article you wrote, published without my consent. Do you deny you did this, yes or no?
I did it.
I don't deny a thing. Did you do it single-handed?
Of course I did. It wasn't God, not in the least.
I give you the honour of writing on your brother's war achievements with one rule, that you keep your very vocal opinions on the other brother quiet. But like father, like daughter, passionate, wild, you still haven't learned to bend before adversity. Why did you go against me? Was it some mad act of defiance?
Yes, because that's the whole story. You can't edit out a person's life.
Peter brought this upon himself. The public loves a war hero, not sob stories. Sob stories don't sell. Who gave you the right to publish such nonsense? What was the point?
What was the point? I went back to my post when you told me to write for Edward, but not for Peter. And with those threats of yours breathing down my neck, I felt a whirlwind of thoughts, twisting up a great dust storm from the earth, a black plague of the heavens filling the plague, ripping off every leaf of every tree in sight, choking the air and sky. And when it was done, my article was written and published, and people will remember my brothers for who they really were.
That was the point, Charlie. Were you aware this would have brought shame on the company?
Well aware. How could I avoid it? It was public.
And you still had the gall to do it.
If it meant saving my brother's reputation, then of course.
I specifically asked you not to write it. There are rules in place, expectations.
These rules I was not about to break them, not out of fear of your wounded pride.
My wounded pride? You have always been disrespectful. But I hate it more that you are trying to glorify your actions.
Of course I am. Think of who they were. My brothers. Your nephews. You love them both. Please, don't throw away the memories of them to spite me.
Spite you? This isn't spite. This is saving the company's reputation.
What more do you want them to fire me?
Oh, nothing. Then I have it.
Then why delay? Your moralising repels me. Every word that you say. I stand by what I did. It was the right thing to do.
You alone, of all people in Thebes, see things that way.
Oh, they see it just that way, but are afraid to lose their jobs.
Aren't you ashamed of yourself? So disloyal.
Not ashamed, not for a moment. Not if it means saving my brother's reputation.
How can you honour Peter when he, a coward, deserted his country?
But it was my brother, not
And wasn't Edward your brother too? Cut down defending his country? Such an honourable death deserves far more glory than suicide.
They lived equally honourable lives and you know it.
If you honour the traitor just as much as
Edward, Edward died fighting on our behalf. Not a coward. Killing himself. I was born to join in love, not hate. Death, it longs for the same rights for all.
Could we talk in private?
Well, we're all being open and honest today, so why not out here?
It wasn't just Annie. I helped her. I share the guilt, the consequences
not
too.
Not you. You were unwilling. I never brought you in.
I am not ashamed to sail through trouble with you. I agreed to send the final article to the edit without you being told.
Don't lay claim to what you never touched.
I am just as much to blame as you, sister. Stop this. This is madness. Why abuse me so? It doesn't help you now.
If I abuse you, I take no pleasure from it, only pain.
Don't reject me, please. How can I help you?
Save yourself. I don't grudge you your survival.
Oh, no, no. You can't afford to lose your job.
I'm better off without it.
Better off?
Who did the work?
I'm your sister, your friend!
I have no love for a friend who loves in only words alone!
Enough! Enough! You and your talk of friendship! Get out! You're fired!
Mm-hmm.
now welcome Mr. Thomas to say a few thank yous for those that helped this production to take place.
Good evening. Well, the energy and the talent that's been on display tonight has really blown me away. Lots of power in the stories, particularly that last piece. Thank you so much, and good luck with your final performance in a couple of weeks' time. We've heard, of course, that the wider picture with the arts is that they are struggling. COVID has hit them very hard. And thank you to everybody that has already donated. I think we're 75% of the way there now. Thank you for the thumbs up. That is true. 75%. If you can give any more, then please indeed do so. And the arts, of course, have been hit at Bluecoat too. COVID took the wind out of our sails. But although early on it was clear that the inspector calls and inspector calls needed to be adapted, I am so proud of the way that drama at Reading Bluecoat has risen and adapted and been flexible and overcome all the obstacles that have been put before them. It has been a joy watching this evening. And I've got some thank yous that it would be remiss of me not to give. Thank you, first of all, to the students, the performers themselves, who really have embraced this new way of creating theatre with such energy and positivity, as we've all seen this evening. The Sodexo team that supported things, Leslie, Amy, and the whole team, for incredible catering and support that's kept the crew going in their rehearsals. Sandra in housekeeping has been brilliant too, not just keeping everything COVID clean, but providing lots of sewing for the costumes. Thank you, Sandra. Miss Amy Thomas has, as always, been an asset to the drama department with her attention to detail and her continuous support. Miss Sarah Piper, Mr. Tom Strudwick, who've been exceptional with their marketing and assisting in the organisation of fundraising for the Royal Theatre Fund. Keep those donations coming. The technical crew, nothing can happen without them. And under the excellent guidance, as always, of Mr. Chris Bond, who in just 4 weeks, a very short space of time, have shaped the way that we create theatre and the arts for this community at school. The tech crew are often the unsung heroes behind the cameras and out of the light, but they are worth their weight in gold. And to the newest addition of Bluecoat's drama department, Mr. Josh Stone, who's been instrumental in tonight's success. His energy, his creativity, and his attention to detail have been wonderful. It's been a brilliant start to his Bluecoat career. So thank you very much, Mr. Stone. But of course, none of this would have happened without the effort and the direction of Mr. Muller. Relentless positivity is a hallmark of this man. He instills confidence and enjoyment, meaning that not only is the very best brought out in the people, but a can-do attitude ensures that ways through and over and round obstacles are always found. And that's exactly what we've seen tonight with our brilliant performances. So thank you, everybody involved, for a wonderful evening, and I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Back over to you.
Our next upcoming full school performance is going to be in support of and inspired by the charity The Show Must Go On. The show is going to be distributed between year group bubbles and pay homage to some of the best musicals of all time. There's still plenty of time to get involved as auditions start next week. We encourage everyone to get involved to what is sure to be another spectacular display of drama to be performed in February of 2021. Please get involved and help us support yet another amazing cause.
But before we wrap up for tonight, we have the final extract of an inspector calls to end the show. We hope you have enjoyed the evening, and for the last time, please donate whatever you can. There is still time. It doesn't matter how small or how large, every donation helps. Thank you for watching. We hope to be able to welcome you back into the theatre as soon as we can. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Good night.
Good night.
I think you ordered something terribly wrong, and that I'm going to spend the rest of your life regretting it. I wish you'd been here tonight in the infirmary. You've seen...
Stop it, stop it! I've imagined it enough already!
And the next time you imagine it, just remember this girl's going to have a child.
Oh, horrible, horrible! How could she have wanted to kill herself?
Because she'd been turned out and turned down too many times. This was the end.
Mother, you must have known.
Because she was going to have a child, then she went to her mother's committee for help.
Look here! This wasn't Gerald Croft.
No, no, nothing to do with him. Make it any less yours. She came to us at a time when no woman could have needed it more. You not only refused that help, but sought with the others refused it too. She was here alone, friendless, almost penniless, desperate. She needed not only your money, but advice, sympathy, kindness. You've had children, you must have known. And you slam the door in her face.
Mother, I think that it was cruel and vile.
I must not say, Sybil. When this comes out at the inquest, this is going to do us a lot of good. The press might easily take
it. Stop it, both of you! And please remember before you start accusing me again that it wasn't I who had her turned out of her employment, which probably began it all. Given the circumstances, I think I was justified. She began telling us a pack of lies.
Which angered you?
Quite rightly. Afterwards, I found out that she, in fact, knew who the father really was. She was quite certain of that. And so I told her that it was her business to make him responsible. If he refused to marry her, and in my opinion, he ought to be compelled to, then he must at least support her.
What did she reply to that?
Some silly nonsense.
What was it?
Whatever it was, I know that it finally made me lose all patience with her. She was giving herself ridiculous airs. She was claiming fine, elaborate feelings and scruples that were just absolutely ridiculous for a girl in her position.
Her position now is that she lies with burnt out inside and was sad anymore. Losing all patience with you people. What did she say?
Oh, a lot of silly nonsense. I didn't believe a word of it.
You're not asking me if you believed it. I want to know what she said. What reason did she give for not taking his money?
She had some fancy reason. As if the girl of that sort would ever refuse money.
I warn you, you're making it worse for yourself. Why didn't she take this boy's money?
Her story was that he had said something one night when he was drunk that gave her the impression that it wasn't his money.
Whose was it then?
He'd stolen it.
So she'd come to your assistance because she didn't want to take this boy's stolen money?
That's the story she finally told after I refused to believe her original one, that she was a married woman who'd been deserted by her husband. I saw no reason to believe that one story was any truer than the one that she told me. So if you think that I should regret what I did, you will find you're mistaken.
But if her story was true, that this boy had been giving her stolen money, then she'd come to your assistance because she wanted to keep this boy out of any more trouble, isn't that so?
Possibly. But it seemed absolutely ridiculous to me. So I was justified in advising my committee not to accept her claim.
You're not even sorry now, but you know what happened to the girl.
I'm sorry that she came to such a horrid end, but naturally I accept no blame.
And who is to blame then?
Firstly, the girl herself. For letting father and me have her chucked out of her job. Secondly, I blame the young man that was the father of the child that she was going to have. If, as you said, he wasn't in her class, and he was some drunk young idler, then that's all the more reason that he shouldn't escape. He should be made an example of. If her death is due to anybody, then it's due to him.
If her story is true, that his boy was giving her stolen money.
Well, there's no reason to assume.
But suppose we do assume, what then?
He'd be entirely responsible, because she'd never have come to my committee and asked for assistance.
So he's the chief culprit anyhow?
Certainly, and he ought to be dealt with very severely.
But stop, stop!
Be quiet, Sheila!
Don't you see?
You're behaving like a hysterical child tonight. If you had taken the steps to find this young man and make sure that he confessed publicly his responsibility, instead of coming here and asking these unnecessary questions, then you would really be doing your duty.
Don't worry, Mrs. Burley. I shall do my duty.
I'm glad to hear it.
No, Ashina, eh? Make an example of the young man, public confession of responsibility?
Certainly. I will consider it your duty. And now, no doubt, you'd like to say goodnight.
Not yet. I'm waiting.
Waiting for what?
To do my duty.
But, Mother, don't you see? But, I mean... Look, it's ridiculous after... This...
Inspector, you will not try to tell us that. My boy? He's mixed up in this as well?
If he is, then we know what to do. Mrs. Burling has just told us.
I don't believe it and I won't believe it.
Mother, I beg you and beg you to stop.
You know that?
Yes, we know.
Oh, Eric, I don't believe it. You don't know what we've been saying.
It's a good job for him if he doesn't, isn't it?
Why?
Because Mother's been busy blaming everything on the young man who got this girl into trouble and saying that he should be made the example of.
That's enough, Sheila!
We haven't exactly made it much easier for me, have you, Mother?
Well, I didn't know it was you. I never dreamt. Besides, you're not the type. You don't get drunk.
Of course he is. I told you he did.
You told her? Oh, you lit in sleep!
No, that's not fair, Eric. I could have called her months ago, but of course I didn't. I only told her tonight because I knew everything was coming out anyways, and it's better that she knew in advance. Don't forget, I've already been through it.
Sheila, I simply don't understand your attitude.
Neither do I. If you'd had any sense of loyalty.
Just a minute, Mr. Burling. There'll be plenty of time to adjust your family relationships once I've gone. But now I must hear what your son has to tell me. And I'll be obliged if we can get on with it without any further interruptions. Now then.
Can I have a drink first?
No!
Yes! I know he's your son, this is your house. But look at him. He needs a drink now just to see him through.
Right. Go on.
When did you meet this girl?
Last November.
Where did you meet her?
I was at the palace bar with a few chaps. I was a bit squiffy.
What happened then?
We talked for a bit. She was a bit far gone by the time we had to leave.
Was she drunk too?
She said afterwards she was a bit. Cheeky because she hadn't had much to eat that day.
You went with her to her lodgings that night?
Yes. I insisted, it seems. I was in that state where a man could easily turn nasty and I threatened to make a row.
She let you in?
Yes. And that's when it happened. I can't even remember it, but that's the ghastly thing. How stupid this all is.
Oh, Eric, how could you?
Sheila, take your mother to look to the drawing room.
But I want
you to- You heard what I said! Go on, Sybil.
When did you meet her again?
About a fortnight afterwards.
By appointment?
No. I couldn't remember her name or where she lived.
More drinks?
Yes, though. This time I wasn't so bad.
But you took her home. Again.
Yes, and we talked a bit. She told me about herself and I mentioned what I did in my name.
And you made love. Again.
Yes. I didn't love her or anything. She was pretty and a good sport.
So you have to go to bed with her?
Well, I'm old enough to be married, aren't I? And I'm not married. I hate these fat old tarts I see walking around town with your respectable friends.
I won't have any of that talk!
I don't want any of that talk from either of you. You can settle it afterwards. Did you arrange to see her after that?
Yes. And the next time, or the time after that, she thought she was going to have a baby. She wasn't so sure. And then she was.
And of course she was very worried about it.
Yes. As was I was in a hell of a state about it.
Did she propose you want to marry her?
No.
child, only not as almost as old as she was.
So, what did you propose to do?
Well, she hadn't any money, and I wasn't going to get a job, so I decided to fix her up with as much money to keep her going.
How much did you give her altogether?
I suppose we were told about £50.
£50? On top of drinking and going around the town?
Yes.
Where did you get this £50 from?
That's my question too.
I got it from the office.
My office?
Yes.
You mean you stole the money?
No, not really.
What do you mean, not really?
This isn't my fault. I'm sorry, Arthur, but I simply couldn't say that.
Well, I can tell you what's happening. He admitted he was responsible for the girl's condition. And get this, now he's telling us he supplied me the money he stole from the office.
Eric, you stole money?
No, not really. I intended to pay it back. We've heard that story before. How could you pay it back?
I would have managed somehow. I'd have to save some up.
I don't understand how you could take as much as that out of the office without somebody knowing about it.
It's a couple of small accounts.
Came the phone's receipt and they kept the money, eh?
Yes. You must give me a list of those accounts. I've got to cover this up as soon as I can.
You damn fool! Why didn't you come to me as soon as you found yourself in this mess?
Because you're not the type of father that the son goes to when he's in trouble.
Don't talk to me like that. You know what your problem is? You've been spoiled.
My trouble is that I haven't much time. You'll be able to divide responsibility between you once I've gone. Just one last question. That's all. This girl discovered that you were giving her stolen money, didn't she?
Yes. That was the worst of it. Found out it was stolen and she'd never see me again. Hey, how do you know that? Did she tell you?
No, she told me nothing. I never spoke to her.
She told Mother. Gina, he has to know.
She told you? Did she come here? But then she could not. She didn't know I loved. She just thought I lived here. Tell me what happened. Don't just look at me. Tell me what happened.
She went to your mother's committee for help after she'd done with you. Your mother refused that help.
Then you killed her! Yes, you killed her! She came to you to protect me and you turned her away! And her child, and my child, your own grandchild, you killed them
both!
Listen to me. I don't need to know any more. Neither do you. The girl killed herself and died a horrible death. But each one of you helped to kill her. Remember that. Never forget it. Then I don't think you ever will. Remember what you did, Mrs. Burling. You turned her away when she needed you most. You refused even the pitiful little organised charity you had in your power to grant her. Remember what you did.
My God, I'm not likely to forget.
Yes. You just used her for a stupid drunken evening. As if she was a thing. An animal, not a person.
Yes,
no, you won't forget.
I know. I had her turned out of her job. I started it.
You helped, but didn't start it. You started it. She wanted 25 shillings a week instead of 22 and sixpence. You made her pay a heavy price for that. And she'll make you pay a heavier price still.
Look, Inspector. Right, it's thousands. Yes, thousands!
You're offering money at the wrong time, Mr. Burling. No, I don't think you will forget. Not that young man, Croft. Though at least he had some affection for her and made her happy for a while. Well, Eva Smith is gone. You can't do her any harm now. You can't do her any good either. You can't even say sorry.
That's the worst of it.
Remember this. One Eva Smith is gone. But there are millions and millions and millions of Eva Smiths and John Smiths still left with us. With their lives, their hopes and fears, their suffering and chance of happiness all intertwined with our lives, with what we think and say and do. We don't live alone. We're members of one body. We're responsible for each other. And I tell you, when the time comes, soon will men have to learn that lesson. If they don't, they'll be taught it with fire and blood.
blood and anguish.